Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2017 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I remind everyone to switch their mobile phones to silent as they may interfere with broadcasting. Agenda item one today is an invitation to Emma Harper, who joins the committee today, and a very warm welcome. It's an invitation to Emma to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. I am Parliamentary Liaison Officer for Fergus Ewan, who is the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and Connectivity.
Thank you very much. Agenda item two is an agreement to take business in private. Second item today for the committee is a review of the format of the Code of Conduct for members of the Scottish Parliament, and it's a decision to take our deliberation on that at future meetings in private. Members will be aware that we asked clerks to look at simplifying the code with a view to make it more accessible and readable whilst not changing any of the existing rules. So can I have the agreement of the committee to review the code in private at future meetings? Yep. Thank you very much. Agenda item three is on cross-party groups. The first group we have to consider today is the proposed CPG on WASPI, that's Women Against State Pension Inequality, and I would like to welcome Richard Leonard, MSP, to the meeting this morning, and I would invite Richard as co-convener of the proposed group to make an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks very much for the invitation and the time this morning. The cross-party group on Women Against State Pension Inequality has two formidable conveners in the shape of Jackie Bailey and Sandra White. The group arises from a grassroots campaign which was sparked off in 2015 in response to the implications of the 1995 and the 2011 Pensions Acts, which accelerated the state retirement age for women from 60 to 65 and then to 66 and 67. And the controversy was sparked really because there was little or no individualised notification of these changes, because there were considerable concerns that there was an acceleration in the time from the original timetable, and so that many women had little time to prepare. It's estimated that there are around 250,000 women in Scotland alone, born in the 1950s, who are affected by these pension changes. There are 24 local groups right across Scotland, from Sutherland in the north to Berwick, Roxburgh in the south. And the secretariat for the cross-party group would be provided by one of the activists in the Lanarkshire group, Anne Potter. The cross-party nature of the group, I think, is represented in the submission that we've made. It includes Patrick Harvey and Alison Johnson from the Scottish Green Party, three Scottish Labour members and four MSPs from the Scottish National Party. We do not think that this cross-party group will especially overlap with any other already existing cross-party groups. There will, I think, be occasions when cross-fertilisation would be helpful. Both Sandra White and I, for example, are on the cross-party group on older people, age and ageing, and maybe that there'll be some shared interests there. I suppose, in conclusion, the main purpose of the group is to raise awareness, both inside Parliament but also outside. There are still women out there in Scotland that do not know that they are affected by these changes, and so we would see ourselves as having a role in trying to raise awareness. The demands of the WASPI campaign are pretty straightforward. They are demands for fair transitional arrangements to be put in place for all women born in the 1950s who are affected by these changes. So I guess in short it's a demand for justice and for equality. We think that this Parliament is close to the people, is in touch with the people. This is an issue which is of grave concern to a large number of women in Scotland, and it's precisely the kind of cross-party group which we think the Parliament should initiate.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leonard. Are there any questions from the committee regarding this group? Daniel? Yeah, Mr. Johnson?
Yeah. a very important issue, and I think it's you know, well worth the focus of a CPG. So I think I'll look forward to looking at your future work with interest.
Ms. Harper, yeah.
Thank you, Convener. I actually think this is a great idea as well. And just in addition, I think there is a Dumfries and Galloway WASPI group, so they might not be aware of the fact that they need to connect up with everybody. So I think I'll certainly be happy to make them aware if this is going to go ahead.
Everyone, well, can I thank you very much for your attendance this morning. The committee will consider whether to approve the application for recognition at agenda item 5, and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible. But thank you very much for
thank
your attendance
you very much
this
indeed.
Morning.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'll suspend slightly to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you. The second cross-party group we have to consider today is a proposed CPG on inflammatory bowel disease. I would like to welcome Colin Smyth, MSP, to the meeting. Colin is a member of the proposed group, and I should declare an interest as also being a proposed member of the group. So I'd invite Mr. Smyth to make an opening statement on the proposed group.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to the committee for the invitation this morning. Inflammatory bowel disease is a collective term we use for Crohn's disease and ulcerative disease. These are lifelong conditions which can develop at any age, but usually in the early teens and early 20s. IBD affects approximately 300,000 people in the UK. That's 1 in 210, with 18,000 new cases diagnosed every year. And in Scotland, 26,000 people are diagnosed with the condition, the highest rate of IBD in the UK. The reason I say this, Convener, is one of the main reasons why the CPG was proposed is the fact that few people are aware of the number of people affected by what can be an incredibly debilitating condition. A core aim of the group is to raise awareness of the high incidence of IBD and the impact that living with IBD has on sufferers' lives. As well as raising awareness of IBD and its effects, the CPG aims to be a forum for third sector organisations and health professionals to share best practice in the diagnosis, research and treatment of IBD. A major focus of the group's work would be on promoting and monitoring the implementation of the National Blueprint for Inflammatory Bowel Disease in Scotland, which was produced through a collaboration between Crohn's and Colitis UK, NHS health professionals and patients in the Scottish Government. The blueprint is key to delivering the Scottish Government's commitment that those in Scotland living with IBD are able to access the best possible treatment and support. Currently, there are no other groups in Parliament looking at the issues specifically faced by people with IBD. Lifetime treatment of IBD per individual affected is comparable to the cost to other major diseases such as diabetes and cancer. However, at present, it's a condition that doesn't receive a great deal of attention. We therefore feel that the CPG is very much in the public interest and that it will make a useful and practical contribution to the development of treatments and services for those suffering from IBD, as well as raise awareness of the condition across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I invite any questions from members? Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I think you've hit the nail on the head when you're saying that an attempt to try and raise awareness for this whole process, I think, is what the group will do. How will you manage to get that across the various sectors? I mean, you've indicated in the report that you're going to have a number of organisations participating. Is any one of those organisations going to take a lead on the process to ensure that it's covering geographically across the piece?
Certainly, the secretary will be provided by Crohn's and Colitis UK, who have increased their work in Scotland. They now have a member of staff actually funded through the Alliance. One of the key roles is actually to lead raising awareness across Scotland. I think one of the opportunities and one of the first pieces of work that we want to do is just raise awareness across health boards in Scotland. So, for example, we've invited the chair of the chief executives of health boards in Scotland to come to a future meeting to make them aware of concerns around, for example, almost a postcode lottery, if you like, in terms of treatment in Scotland, and just to make him aware of the concerns of people who suffer from this condition, and the fact that we do have different treatments in different parts of Scotland. One of the key things for the group is it does have individuals who suffer from this condition, and their stories were, I have to say, at the first meeting, very harrowing, and we really want to raise awareness of how this impacts on individuals and their lives, and that's certainly be a key part of the role of the group.
Thank you, I wish you well. Thank you, Kevin.
Any further questions? Thank you, committee. Can I thank Colin Smyth for his attendance at committee this morning? We will consider whether to approve the application for recognition at agenda item 5, and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible. But thank you for your attendance this morning.
Thank you, Kevin.
Suspend. The final group we have to consider today is a proposed CPD on freedom of religion or belief. I would like to welcome John Mason, MSP, to the meeting, and John is a proposed convener of the group. I invite you to make an opening statement. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, convener, and thanks to the committee for considering this CPG for approval. As members may know, there was a similar cross-party group specifically on religious freedom, previously led by Dave Thompson. But we deliberately did not carry it on and wanted to actually restart in a slightly different format. But there will obviously be similarities with that. We considered different options and discussed that at our inaugural meeting. But we came up with this, the phrase freedom of religion or belief, which is somewhat wider than the previous one, which only mentioned religion. I think members have the registration form, and I can only apologise that we did not properly notify the clerks about that inaugural meeting. That was an oversight, I'm afraid, on the part of myself and my office. I also realised that when I was looking at the form this morning, Alec Cole-Hamilton is down as a Conservative, and obviously he's not. So my apologies to him. And so we, in fact, have one, at least one MSP from every of the five parties, which is quite encouraging. The vice conveners to be Murdo Fraser, and we now have a secretariat in place, which is Interfaith Scotland, which was not at the time we completed the form. I mean, I think that religion is a major part of many people's lives, both in Scotland and around the world. And it's a major reason why people around the world are having a difficult time in quite a number of countries. And there is no other CPG that specifically looks at religion, although I agree it can touch on many areas. And just to take one country, for example, say like North Korea, it would be at the top of most people's list for being a repressive regime, and people within that, and certainly religious people, but anyone who basically doesn't agree with the regime has an extremely difficult time in a country like that. Now, a cross-party group can't solve these problems, but I think we can air them, we can discuss some of the situation and what people are suffering and what they're going through in these countries like that. So I would very much hope the committee would approve the group, but I'm very happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mason. So invite any questions from the committee this morning. Mr. Harvey.
Good morning. Just looking at the new title compared with the previous group that covered this area, I think the previous group was criticised to some extent for being focused on freedom of religion, in a narrow way, not encompassing freedom from religion, which the phrase religious freedom obviously should cover both. So can you say something about how you expect the work of this group to differ, whether its remit is intentionally broader, and also in relation to its membership? I noticed there are no non-religious belief organisations yet listed. How do you anticipate that changing?
Well, firstly, we're certainly open to anybody being part of the group and attending if they want to. We can encourage, and we have, in fact, been in touch. I think the Humanist Society was invited to the first meeting and declined to come, if I remember correctly. But obviously, it was only at that first meeting we decided exactly what the remit would be, and I think some people had maybe thought it would just be religion. So, as you've noted, we specifically are widening it out. And we'd be happy to take, anybody who wants to be a member, MSPs, individuals and organisations. However, I suppose I would also say at the moment that, you know, I think religion can be overlooked in some circles, and I do think there will be a focus on religion, but not exclusively on religion. And then within religions, I mean, there clearly are different experiences. I mean, Muslims in Myanmar, for example, are facing a very difficult time, Falun Gong in China and so on. But the main group, main religious group being persecuted around the world are Christians. So just inevitably, I think there's likely to be a focus on that.
But regardless of whether any particular organisations choose to get involved, you would say that the remit covers not only the freedom of people to practice religion, but also the right of people to be free of having religion imposed on them.
Absolutely. Because both, I think, leaving a religion for another religion or leaving a religion for no religion are both areas of real concern.
Or not having had one. Just to ask then about one comment. I see that most of your focus is expected to be on the international aspect, but I think it says we could look at issues in Scotland and the UK. I wonder if you could outline what some of those might be and whether you anticipate any difficulties around conflicts or tensions between religion and other equality strands and how you might deal with those.
Yeah, well, that raises a whole range of issues, I think. I mean, we've left it deliberately open, but my thinking is that the main emphasis, and in fact, I think that the previous group as well, the main emphasis was on the overseas situation. But yes, I have mentioned the Equality Act, and as it happens, I was involved in that act going through at Westminster. And there can be a tension between the different protected characteristics because they were not ranked and neither did the Act say they were all equal. So I think that when the Act was written, that was an inherent flaw in it, that they should either have said everything was equal or there was some kind of ranking. So I accept there can be tensions. I doubt very much that this group will get into that kind of thing because we are focusing on the religious side. But, I mean, if the situation did arise that there was some problem with people being religious, or I think one of my colleagues was criticised for having ash on her forehead at Ash Wednesday, you know, these things are obviously of interest, but I don't think they'll be the main focus of the group.
And finally, in the last session, the previous group had an organisation appointed to provide its secretariat. I don't see a decision on that in the current paper, and I wonder if you've considered the criticisms that were made of the organisation that was chosen in the last session, which cites its founder as saying that its purpose includes to heal the wounds inflicted by atheism, and whether you've considered that and reflected on whether that was appropriate.
Well, I mean, maybe that's one of the reasons why we have said we're starting a new group rather than continuing the previous one. So I do see it as a new group. We discussed the secretariat at the initial meeting, which unfortunately Interfaith Scotland had not been able to attend, so they couldn't decide on the day. But everybody felt that they would be a very appropriate group because by their very name, they are interfaith. And so when we asked them, they considered it had to go through their board, and they've now agreed to provide that secretarial support.
Certainly think that would be an improvement.
Well, I'll let you judge that.
Thank you.
Any further questions from the committee regarding the CPG? No. Can I thank John Mason for his attendance this morning? The committee will consider whether to approve the application for recognition at Agenda Item 5, and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible. But thank you for your attendance this morning.
You.
I'm going to suspend shortly, just to allow witnesses to change over. We now move to agenda item 4, which is an evidence session with the Commission on Parliamentary Reform. We're delighted to welcome to committee this morning John McCormick, Chair of the Commission, and John Finnie, MSP Commission Member. I would like to invite Mr McCormick to make an opening statement to the committee.
Thank you very much, Convener. John and I are delighted to be here, and thank you for inviting us. Just a brief statement from me, and then hopefully we can cover other ground in questions. The last time we spoke to you, when Fiona McLeod and I were here, we talked about the three stages of our work on the Commission for Parliamentary Reform. First, the planning stage, and then the engagement stage, and now the reporting stage. So we have completed the planning stage and the engagement phase, and we're just in the early stages of considering all the evidence before us and before we agree our recommendations. And we're still on target to provide our report to the presiding officer and Parliament by the end of June. Since we last spoke, we've had 12 formal meetings at which we've taken evidence from some 55 witnesses. We've travelled across Scotland, taking part in workshops and meetings and conferences and seeking views on how people feel the Parliament's working. We've met some 1,200 people at over 50 events. We've included, of course, those who have deep experience of working with the Parliament, but as well those who might not think of becoming involved and would not think the Parliament was for them. We've met representatives of the black and minority ethnic communities, homeless people, disability groups, for example, and we can talk more about that afterwards if you want to know more detail. We've had 104 written submissions, and they're all available for you to read on our website, from half a page to 52 pages, and we have provided a very helpful summary. And we have appointed Professor Paul Kearney of Stirling University to act as our advisor. We've also undertaken a range of research looking at what we might learn from comparator legislatures across the world. And we have a very strong paper assessing the impact of new deliberative engagement techniques in different parts of the world. And SPICE have provided a very, very helpful analysis of the four sessions of this Parliament, and the data makes very interesting reading. And we're going through that at the moment to see what trends there are and what lessons we can learn from that. I would have to say at the outset, the impression from the engagement across the country is very positive. I've been very struck by how people value the Parliament, and with many seeing the MSP as their key link to those who make decisions on their behalf. And the fact that each of the individual MSPs bring the feeling and experience of their community into this Parliament at Holyrood. Even if people we've met say, well, I'm not too interested in the detail or whatever, I'll just trust my MSP to go on with the job, and that's fine with me. But the overarching feeling of the Parliament's of great value, great respect for the Parliament, and it's held in high esteem. So we're now at the stage of reflecting on all this evidence, setting priorities, and emerging recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Could I open you? You said you're still on track to present to the presiding officer at the end of June. I was wondering if events this week in the general election would have any impact on your ability to meet that deadline.
I can't think it will have any impact at all. We're determined to, if it's to be helpful at all, we want to stick to our timetable and presenting it to the Parliament before the session. I think it will put an extra burden on my colleagues, the political nominees on the Commission, who will be engaged in other things that I won't be engaged in. But no, we're on track.
Thank you very much. Could I invite questions from the committee? Mr. Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. I think you're to be commended and congratulated for the extent that you've done so far. I mean, it was only a few weeks ago that you came here, and you now have had an opportunity to go out there and experience and have dialogue, and I think that's been very positive from what I can see from what you've given back. My question would be about how you managed to get involved with those people who were less, or perceived as being lessly involved with the Parliament, and saw their role in life as being part of that process. It would be good to have an indication as to how that came about, because I think that is the market and the groups that we're trying to engage with, and you took that challenge on, and I'd like to hear a little bit more about that.
Well, we could both respond on this issue. We contacted a lot of groups when we, at the outset, explained what we were about and asked for their help. And, for example, we met, we asked people if they were holding conferences or workshops, could we take part? Could they give us some time in an event that was already in the calendar? Or could we arrange an event? So with the SEMVO, we had a conference in Easterhouse, a group meeting in Easterhouse of people representing different aspects of diversity. We had Commission for Racial Equality political mentoring scheme. We had a meeting here in the Parliament of people who are on that scheme. The Cyrenians helped us to meet people who had suffered homelessness or had been in care. So we went through a range of organisations and they were terrifically helpful to us across the whole country, you know. So we met in from Arica to Skye to Easter House, even Inverness, John.
No, and we also thought it was important to engage with people where they would be comfortable. Yeah. So, for instance, and the commissioners went in groups, sometimes individually. For instance, I met with a group of looked-after children in Falkirk at their normal meeting place on a Wednesday night. I very much enjoyed the pizza that they laid on. It was important to engage with people like that. Similarly, and again, to be parochial, in my area, we met with Lochaber Disability Forum at a location where they would ordinarily be meeting, Highland Senior Citizens Network. So all ranges and all sectors of the community, we were keen to get all the views.
And I think that by doing that, then you will have a real flavour of what is out there and what people's perceptions and their beliefs are of the organisation that we have here. And as I say, it's good to hear that there is a good high level of respect and value from all across the sector. And I thank you for that. Thank you, Convener.
Can I bring Ms Harper in?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning and thanks for coming today. This is my first meeting of the Standards Committee and I was reading information ahead of the today. And in discussions around parliamentary reform, a lot of people are interested in how we market the work that we do here versus Westminster, for instance, and a lot of what is seen as First Minister's questions on a Thursday, when there's actually a lot happening in committees and things like that as well. And just yesterday, one of the local farmers referred to this place as the Scottish office. And I find that quite a challenge, actually, when people are still referring to this Parliament and the government as an office. So I'm interested to know about how do we explore the work of the Parliament and getting the information out there.
Certainly, the part of our remit is to look at the identity of the Parliament as distinct from the government and the role of the individual parliamentarian. So we're looking at a whole range of issues that have been raised with us about strengthening the role of the individual parliamentarian, strengthening the role of the committees and their conveners, the relationship between the committees and the chamber in terms of when issues are being discussed here, what's the relationship to what's happening in the chamber. So we're looking at a whole range of issues across the board, John, aren't we?
Indeed, and identity is key to that, to enhance the role, because shorthand, people all use shorthand and we're guilty, and sometimes the term Holyrood is used to refer to government, to the building, to the committees, to the whole political structure. So it was to try and understand that, and there is a level of knowledge out there. For instance, one of the groups that I met with initially said, no, we don't know anything about the Parliament, and then, oh, nothing at all. Well, we did that thing in primary school, and then a third of them had visited. This was the group in central Scotland. So there's a lot of knowledge out there, but you're right. A key element is to try and break down the components of what's clearly the party of government, the Parliament, and the different and the civil support as well. The parliamentary staff that support and also the government staff, and have the clear distinction between them. And to say, a recurring theme was that the term Holyrood was a shorthand that confused.
And we did have a session with the media where we discussed that very issue about their reporting of the Parliament and how did they distinguish within their guidelines between the different areas of government, civil service, the Parliament, the committees, etc. So we're hoping for some positive feedback following those discussions. But the evidence from around the world, and people have said to us from different legislatures, that it's one of the most difficult things is to identify the role of the Parliament as distinct from the government, because the government gets all the publicity since they're making the decisions. So we're very aware of it. It's not an easy solution, but we will. And some people haven't, you know, I remember when we had an ice-breaking quiz we gave to people about the role of the Parliament and what they did and who was responsible for what, you know. And quite a number of people said to me at different times, I remember a lady in Kilmarnock saying to me when I was back in my home territory, saying, oh, well, it doesn't really matter to me, son. I knew I was back in Ayrshire when she said that, and nobody said that to me for a long time, she said, because I trust my local MSP, and I'll go to him and he'll help me and he'll work it through for me and direct put me in the right direction. So as someone else put it more succinctly in Glasgow, said, it's not a, you're not going to make it compulsory that I've got to understand who's responsible for what, are you? So there is a whole range of the bit. Most people get the gist of it, the things that domestic legislation that matters to their family and to the people they care about is the responsibility of this Parliament, and they work out from there.
Okay, thank you.
If I could ask a supplementary on that question, I know that you have visited other devolved areas and other parliaments as well. Have you found a digital strategy that works perhaps in a more modern way than the one we have in this Parliament? And had there been any representations about the use of digital media on the Parliament websites, for instance? I mean, it's a very basic contact sheet that we have as parliamentarians, and we can't put sort of multimedia on there or have control of what we can put on there. Have you seen other areas that have do it better or differently?
A lot of the legislators, people we spoke to, are dealing with this very issue at the moment because of the pace of change. They've established a setup, and now it needs to be improved or enhanced, and a lot of them are discussing it. We're particularly interested in developments in Wales and the Welsh Assembly, where they've introduced a number of areas of change to engage people through digital. And they have a review team at the moment sitting to report, helpfully in May, before we put in our report, about how they can report on the issues of the Assembly to the people of Wales in a more attractive way, in a more engaging way. And we've been keeping in touch with them, and they've been keeping in touch with us since October. So we're working in parallel with each other. And we had a very helpful session with some digital experts in Gala Shields, where we also had a great team support from senior pupils from Gala Shields Academy. And we spent the day there, and we had terrific evidence from Nesta and other colleagues, including from the Welsh Assembly, about developments in digital. So we'll have something to say about digital engagement in our final report.
That's very helpful, thank you. Is that a supplementary or a new idea?
True.
Like Mr. Atherin, a supplementary.
Thanks. It was just picking up upon a point that you made, Mr. McCormick, regarding people actually are aware that the issues that matter most to their lives are decided here. I just wonder if you could potentially comment, if you've been able to pick anything up, why you think it would be the case that turnout for Holyrood elections is consistently lower than turnout for Westminster elections, and how that relates to people's understanding of the Parliament and its role.
I wouldn't like to speculate on that at all. You know, I've studied turnout over the years in my role as Electoral Commissioner, and it's certainly intriguing whereby, you know, local elections, you would expect the turnout to be lower than here, and for here, you would expect it to be lower than the UK parliamentary elections. But there's been a change in the last few years where Scottish turnout has increased in a number of different electoral events. I wouldn't like to speculate about it, except that people were very clear that if they needed help, they would go to the MSP. It didn't mean to say that they understood precisely everything that mattered, whether refuse collection or roads or transport or licensing were MSP responsibilities or local authority responsibilities. But I felt a great sense of feeling that because health and education were here, that it mattered to the family, and that would be their first port of call. I found that quite encouraging. I would hope it would lead to an increase in the turnout.
But I find it interesting you say that, that people perhaps trust their MSPs to get on with the job, but is it perhaps the case, and just to speculate, that it's not that people are disinterested in Scottish Parliament, it explains the lower turnout, but people are content for the Scottish Parliament to get on with it, and we don't feel a need to actually intervene by voting to the same degree as they do at Westminster?
I couldn't speculate on that, John, could you?
No, I think it's fair to say that part of our work has been about how people have responded to what their understanding of the Scottish Parliament is at the moment. And you know, John's right to talk about the innovation that's applying in Wales about engagement. We want engagement. That means across the range of things, not simply digital engagement. We know there are a number of areas where that isn't very practical. So I think the more engagement there is, then hopefully that will be reflected with a greater interest.
Yes, I mean, I was just sort of keen to talk to you or ask you about the comparative work you've been doing, looking at other legislatures, both devolved and national legislatures of comparable size, and just wondering if what the kind of the emerging themes from that were. Where are the sort of the interesting points of compare and contrast in your view, based on your work so far?
Well, it's interesting. We find that across the board, most are dealing with the sort of issues we are dealing with. You know, the identity of the legislature as against the government. Capacity doesn't seem to be much of an issue. It would seem that looking at the number of elected representatives, that Holyrood is not out of kilter with similar legislatures of similar size across the world. There's not a great difference in the number of people. Where there is a difference is there's quite distinct differences in the role of the presiding officer or speaker. There are some differences in post-legislative scrutiny and pre-legislative scrutiny. There are different ways of organising the chamber time and the committee time. So the allocation of a parliamentary week, we've learnt quite a lot from that, and we have a lot of data about that we're going through at the moment. But generally, it's about managing efficiency and effectively the time that's available from the parliamentarians to do their work, both in the legislature and in their constituencies, and balancing the two.
So I mean, one of the things which I think has been discussed in recent months amongst parliamentarians is that the role of the business managers and the bureau in terms of managing chamber time, but also selection of speakers. And it's clearly one of the big points of contrast between Holyrood and Westminster is the role of the speaker in choosing speakers in the House of Commons compared to the Scottish Parliament, where it tends to be nominated by business managers. Are any of these sort of procedural points going to form part of your work? Are there any sort of, again, emergent themes in terms of the way the process and procedure could be reformed to increase sort of spontaneity and increase the range of views that are heard in the chamber?
Yeah. Yes, we're looking at a whole range of issues relating to parliamentary time, parliamentary debates, the role of the presiding officer. We've got a whole range of ways we're looking at it, and also the work of the committees in terms of engagement and in scrutiny of legislation and the balance of work between their two roles, as for most of the committees, you know, the legislative role and the select committee role, and the balance between them, and looking at the practice varies between legislatures as to whether the chamber can meet when committees meet in parallel and what the unintended consequences of that. And different legislators have responded in different ways.
There's fairly recent experience in the Republic of Ireland regarding how they've gone about business. So you know, we've also looked at New Zealand and other places, but they are the particular point, and we've had a number of representations on the ability of the presiding officer, speaker, call them what they were, and other parliaments to determine that they would select someone to speak on the basis of the known expertise they might have or a background that they may have. So, again, that is about the relationship between party, the individual role of the parliamentarian, and the role of the person who's actually chairing the session. So there's quite a range of information we've had about that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Scott?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, and thank you for your work thus far. I wanted to talk about two things, and you may have said all you wish to say about structural change, or you may not have, in terms of making the Parliament work better and more efficiently, with the perceived, at any rate, increased workload likely to come in terms of post-Brexit and post the implementation of the Scotland Bill, how committees can work better. Have you anything more you'd like to add about that?
Well, we're looking in great detail at the balance of time in committees at the different stages, the time between the stages and when the bill goes into the chamber, and the time there before the decisions are made. So we're looking at it in detail. We're working through it at the moment. I couldn't really say much more than we're taking a very careful look at how the bills are scrutinised in each of the committees, and then how that relates to the decision time in the chamber.
Is there anything else I should add, John?
I was particularly thinking of, you know, committees meeting on a Thursday morning, for example, coming up against hard deadlines of general questions.
Yeah.
That sort of inflexibility that I think some committees find pretty crushing in a way, and the need to perhaps change
Note that,
the sitting times of Parliament.
That point has been made. That point's been made to us very forcibly by a number of MSPs. The particular difficulty of the Thursday morning committees in the chamber and up to 11:30 and all of that. We've also found from the data that, so we are looking at that, of course we are, the best use of the time so that committees can get the work done in proper time and not rushing it to the job, as a number of different people have said to me. We've also found some interesting stats. You know, sometimes you look at the stats and themes emerge and you're not quite sure where it takes you. But I've got one here, for example. We've found that most bills are introduced in the last 15 months of a parliamentary session. This is analysis of the first four sessions. And that more chamber time is spent on bills in the last parliamentary year of the session. And also, interestingly, in session three had the lowest number of bills, but also the lowest number of committee inquiries. So it may not just simply be a time of looking at the parliamentary week. It's maybe looking at the parliamentary year and where chamber time is at its most valuable and most necessary, and where committee time is more valuable and more necessary. So we're looking at all those things. As I say, we haven't taken any firm decisions yet, but we're scrutinising it very carefully.
Okay. The other point I wanted to make was, I'm interested in the places you've been to and what impact does rurality, if you like, have on the feeling of not necessarily being connected with the Parliament? For example, I'm surprised to see you haven't been to Dundee or Perth or in my constituency, Ayr, although I congratulate you on where you have been, but notwithstanding, and without being too critical, it does seem quite sort of central belt focused, and there is a need to, because the people who feel most disconnected are often the people who are the furthest distance away.
To miss an opportunity to go to Ayr, Mr. Scott, I think, as you know, so we have been to Ayrshire, at least I can tick that box. No, we have been to, we've made an attempt to get to around the country, you know, so Inverness, Aberdeen, Galashiels, Arachar, Skye, well, a range of places to get a balance of rurality, island community life and the impact on the Parliament, as well as the Central Belt and the other cities. I'm sorry we missed out Dundee, but we did Aberdeen.
We did. And it was interesting, for instance, in my part of the world, in Fitzwilliam there, there was certainly a view from the people we met at the Disability Forum that the disengagement wasn't so much with Lochaber, with the Parliament in Edinburgh. Ironically, it was Lochaber with the council in Inverness, 65 miles away. There's no doubt that people's experience, individual experience, will shape their views on the Parliament. But by and large, I don't think the distance necessarily was seen as a problem as regards awareness of what was going on, but rather the ability to perhaps come to the Parliament. And it certainly seemed to be in the areas furthest from the Parliament were very appreciative if the Parliament went out. And that was something that we've been looking at again in relation to how the week would be diaried and the ability of the committees to get out and meet people, because we found that was very much appreciated.
Now, that's one of the key issues that's come through, that people, like in Arafat, for example, we piggybacked on the back of an all-day conference that was looking at the Community Empowerment Act. So we had 70, 80 people really involved in the community helping us and talking about this. And they said, we understand it's expensive to come here. We understand that a whole committee, you couldn't expect a whole committee to come to Arachar, say, or parts of Argyll or the islands. But we can't do it digitally. You can do some of it digitally. You can do some of it by telephone conferencing. But there'll be occasions when we would want all the committees to at least consider one or two people from the committee coming to meet us face-to-face in a session like this, like you've done. We don't have the broadband that can allow us to do the digital engagement all across the country. When we can, it's a substitute and a good substitute. But when we've had the local MSPs, when we've had people from the Parliament, it really makes a big difference to the democratic engagement, and we feel we can talk to them on our territory. And a number of people have said that, you know, that it's much easier for them. They understand the difficulties. They're not Pollyannish about it. They realise it's costly of time and resources. but it's so much better for them to meet them in the comfort of their community where they feel confident about talking about it and introduce you to their community issues than coming here. And they feel there are some barriers to coming here to learn the language and the procedures. And
I would, if I may, just like to develop that theme. I mean, so much of the part of parliamentary life is about the cross-party groups. It's about receptions in the evening and attendance at Parliament itself to witness debates. And I'm very aware that, but from my part of Ayrshire, it's almost too far away for people to come to these events, and that must be the case from similar distances in a radius from Parliament. I'm not sure how you might address that in terms of engagement, because that is so important to people's feeling of being engaged with our Parliament and so vital to the success.
Mm-hmm. And involving, certainly, it ties into the discussion earlier on about digital engagement, you know, in the use of digital to allow scrutiny of what the Parliament is doing is quite advanced in some democracies, you know, and in Brazil, for example, you can scrutinise a bill online and put in your comments, that kind of thing. So there's an opportunity from digital. Got to recognise across the country not everybody can do it, and it doesn't get to some of the more local, rural areas who need the involvement, and we learned that lesson very clearly in Inverness. But we had a very interesting submission from the Chief Executives Forum in Northeast in the Grampian region, where they advocated, they said, we deliver services locally here and we're responsible to our electorate for those. But we also have here services that are delivered nationally, and we had round the table the police and the NHS represented, and they're responsible to Holyrood. And what they would like to see is, because there is a regional list system here, we'd like that to be brought to bear in a cross-party way to consider the issues in this case of the northeast of Scotland, so that the list MSPs and the constituency MSPs and the leaders of the local authorities could get together to discuss their issues in a sense of place, in the place where they're making the decisions. It's a very interesting submission.
Are you finished, Mr. Scott?
Yes.
Okay. Can I bring in Mr.
Thank
Harvey?
Thanks very much. Good morning to both of you. I was interested just in those last comments mentioning local authorities. I don't see much in the way of written submissions from local authorities. Have there been any, or do you anticipate hearing more from local authorities at a formal submission level?
We did take evidence from COSLA, Councillor O'Neill at COSLA, and also from, and forgive me, it would be terrible if I get this name wrong, but the Highland Commission on Democracy, which mm-hmm. is a body that has been set up to look, and we had some interesting comments from them. I'm trying to think if we've had, and we have had local elected councillors along at events, and indeed MSPs as well.
And the Northeast Forum, where the chief executives of the local authorities came together to put in a submission. I think the local authorities were doing it through COSLA and represent their views on the national level.
Okay. I was just going to ask a slightly wider question as well, which is just about the process. I mean, obviously, I'm as keen as everybody else to get you to spill the beans on what your conclusions are going to be, but it's a wee bit early for that. Have there been any surprises in the process for you, any unexpected problems that you've encountered, or perhaps any groups or perspectives that have been harder than you anticipated to reach and hear from?
Surprises. We've done a fair bit of work on diversity, and I think a surprise to me as an individual, we might all be surprised by different things, was that this Parliament at the beginning with a very strong representation of males and females, and that seems to have stalled. So it's in the early low 30%, whereas it was higher than that initially. And we've looked at the representation of those with disabilities and those from black and minority ethnic communities. And so we're looking at that. That was a bit of a surprise to me, because I thought this was a leading Parliament in terms of gender balance. And we've seen that in some legislatures, it's the Parliament that sets the standards for representation in terms of diversity across the board, much more widely than the categories I'm mentioning. And so that's been a very interesting area to explore, to make sure this Parliament keeps ahead of that. The other area too, I think, is in the use of technology. Some other places, I would say, individually, personally, making better use of digital technology to interact and engage and feedback to the communities than we've been able to do up to now. Whereas at the outset, certainly, the digital technology here was regarded as very, very advanced at the time. But a lot's happened since 1999.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Ms. Harper, you wanted to again?
Thanks. It's similar to Mr. Scott's rural aspects of it. You know, the online or the Commission's calls for views closed on the 27th of March, but you've been to Dumfries, you've been to Galashiels and Hoyt, I think, and Peebles. So the area I represent, South Scotland region, is massively rural. And because of the challenges for our broadband and connectivity, are you able to track the online submissions by the rural areas? For instance, how many folk submitted from Stranraer, for instance, or are you able to like tease out that kind of data?
That's a good question.
Technical
to take that away. In terms of, I mean, we can
write to the committee about
all the submissions that we have. You know, and the 1,200 people we've met where they've come from, but we haven't been able to track it quite in the way that you've been saying. The impact of engagement with the Parliament in relation to having digital technology at their fingertips and good broadband, I don't think we've got enough data on that to generalise from it. We've got a lot of anecdotal evidence and individual evidence where people have said how important it is that they could engage with the Parliament and use digital technology to do it, but the broadband situation's frustrating and they can't do it. So a lot of anecdotal evidence, but I don't think we've got anything that's statistically valid, but I'll take away and come back to you if I can find that we do have anything, if that's acceptable.
And sometimes I find that as information is rolled out, say, from Edinburgh, then Central Belt, and then it gets to the rural, it just sometimes takes longer for people to hear about surveys and it's already closed. So by the time people will hear about it, it's too late for them to say.
Well, certainly it's a point that's been made to us in terms of consultations in general, that not all consultations are open for a requisite number of weeks so that people can prepare the submissions and get them in. And that's a point of frustration. And also ill-timed consultations over the summer months or Christmas or Easter, that kind of thing. That point's been made to us in general terms. And that's a plea from people to have be able to give their views to a committee on a piece of legislation or on a particular issue that's been scrutinised by a committee.
Okay. I think it's fair to record that on at least one occasion the deadline for submissions has been extended for the very reason we want to maximise the information we do get.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mr. Scott?
On that subject, for not knowing, are you still open to representations being made or has that date now passed?
Well, I'm always open, and I'll keep it open as much as we can for the next couple of weeks, I think, because once we get into May, certainly we'll be doing the granular discussions around the table. Somebody described it to me as arm wrestling. I said, no, we're not like that. We work very cooperatively together. But once we get into May, I'm very happy to speak to anyone and hear from anyone between now and then on additional representations. And we're grateful for the members of your committee convener who have already made submissions to us. Thank you.
Can I pick up on a couple of the points from earlier? If we go back to the issue of capacity, you said that the number of MSPs isn't out of kilter with other devolved administrations. Did you make a comparison on the powers and the devolved responsibilities in that comparison, in that I would say that Scottish Parliament has far more responsibility than, say, the Northern Irish Assembly or Welsh Assembly in terms of devolved powers now? And did you make a comparison on that basis?
Yeah, we have that comparison, of course, in our detail from Spice. But we also compared this parliament to fully freestanding parliaments, you know, national parliaments of a similar size country like New Zealand or Denmark. So we didn't keep it just simply. So we haven't gone into the deep. We've looked at the work this Parliament does compared, we know, with the Assembly in Northern Ireland and in Wales, and that's fine. But with the others, the powers vary greatly. What we are aware of here is the great wave of powers that come in 2012 and 2016 and waiting in the lay-by called Brexit that will no doubt bring more powers to the Parliament. So we're very much aware of the fact that we've got to be aware of the fact this Parliament will have increased powers, and how can we release the time for the proper scrutiny to be done relating to those powers and the engagement with outside bodies and specialist groups, etc. So we're very much aware of that, that it's a reality that it will get, the responsibilities will get greater. And we have to come up with a set of recommendations that's realistic about that, so that it's open when the next wave of responsibilities come to this Parliament, that it's ready to take them on, and I hope our recommendations will take account of that.
Okay, thank you. Obviously, the Parliament is an evolving institution and changes have been made in the past. I'm interested in the comments about the committees being able to get out and about and make that representation. I was sat in the last committee and I was able to, on a committee visit Orkney for a piece of work that we were doing, which was invaluable in our understanding of the issues around that bill. One of the drivers for us sitting through plenary sessions was to be, I think, seen to be doing more work here in the Parliament, but the unintended consequence of that is that committee visits have been curtailed. Is this something that is a theme or something that you've had representation about?
Yeah, no, it is a theme, and very much aware of the fact that, you know, all-day committees allow committees to do work out in different communities that a half-day committee doesn't, and all of that, yes. And when we've had the feedback from people who have met members of committees, it's very gratifying that it's been really appreciated within the communities around Scotland. So it's the use of committee time, where the committee meets, how it engages. We hope to make a number of very clear recommendations relating to that.
Okay. And I do thank you particularly for your visits to diverse organisations like Looked After Children. All of that, I think, is absolutely so important, because I think part of the success of the Commission will be an increase in diversity in the Parliament's representation. But I wondered, there were some of those evidence sessions, I felt, that particularly the one in the media that was mentioned earlier, where the focus seemed to be about how it affected them and their day job, rather than being about, you know, the people of Scotland and your task of increasing scrutiny. So how are you managing to balance these conflicting issues in your deliberations?
Well, a lot of it was connected with the promotion of the Parliament and the Parliament being seen as more than the building and any inhibitors there would be to that promotion, because the media plays an important role. And it was to understand, you know, the issue, because there are limited resources at the disposal, and we understand that they will look at committees and see things that may be of interest. So it was to understand what the implications of some of the changes could be. It's important to say we've tracked the work of the Parliament over its entire period, as you heard earlier from John there, and it is an evolving situation, and it's right that there should be an ongoing check made. That was our engagement with the media, was around that issue primarily, to understand there. And also we did cover the issue of the use of the term Holyrood as well.
No, I was a bit disappointed that it became all about them and how they could get better facilities and better access. There is something in there, you know, to allow the Parliament to be more open to others. But I was a bit. But I'm hoping we can use that when the report's published to go back to them and expect them to explain the role of the Parliament better. And some positive signs on that front.
Okay, Mr. Scott.
In terms of being granular and also at the risk of being parochial and declaring an interest as the convener of the DPLR committee, I do have concerns, as you've already highlighted, when you join up the dots about the post-Brexit era, the amount of subordinate legislation that will need to be looked at. There's discussions around 1,000 statutory instruments coming at any rate to Westminster. We will get our fair share of those, whatever those turn out to be. And when you add that to the fact of what you already said about the pipeline of legislation always coming through in the last 2 or 3 years towards the end of parliamentary sessions, just worry about particularly the capacity of my committee and others, which, and the size of committees vary, to cope with these workloads, which if we think we're busy at the moment, we ain't seen nothing yet, to be frank, in terms of what's coming down the track.
I mean, for some people who have spoken to us, as you know, the increased capacity means an increase in the number of members of the Parliament, or another chamber where there can be further scrutiny. You know, and we've got these issues on the table, but my own view is that you... my own view is that before you can get to the stage of saying you need additional members, you've got to look at the way the parliamentary year is run and how it's organised to see if you can release more energy, more time, more scrutiny, before you could then go with the argument that we need more members. A number of people who have suggested more members have also suggested a reform of the electoral system. And I'm very much aware with my background in the Electoral Commission that you can't introduce a change in the electoral system without a full-hearted review that would take a long number of years. And frankly, you don't have the number of years before the extra powers are going to come if Brexit goes the way we think it will. So we need to come up with... I'm not ruling anything out. We've got everything on the table at the moment, but we need to look at ways of releasing time, energy, and within the 129 MSPs in the way the Parliament does its work, to cope with the extra powers that are coming. If there is to be an increase in MSPs, it will take some time before that could be realised. First of all, agreed, then funded, then realised, and then the electoral system would have to be modified for that. And that's for a commission that's sat for 8 months, that's a big ask to go through the details and the implications of all of that. But we may have something to say about it. We'll have something to say about it. But that would be in the future.
Just for the avoidance of doubt, I wasn't suggesting there was a need for more MSPs, it was how to better allocate.
A lot of our work's been around, if you like, workload analysis, and with the resources you've got, how they might be configured differently. So people have talked about committee sizes, and I know the previous committee made a recommendation in respect of that, and whether being configured slightly different would be able to accommodate the workload. But as John says, we're looking at all the options that have been put to us.
Thank you.
Any further questions? No. I thank you both for your work in this area and also for your attendance at committee. And we look forward to seeing the report towards the end of June, and I'm sure the committee will be returning to it in the session in the autumn. So again, thank you both very
thank
much
you.
For your attendance.
Thank you very much.
Now move to agenda item 5, which is consideration of the cross-party group approval. And I would ask that the committee consider whether to approve, whether they have any comments on the WASPI, Women Against State Pension Inequality, proposed CPG.
Happy to support.
Committee content to support that CPG. Thank you very much. Also on the inflammatory bowel disease CPG, any comments? Nope. Happy content to approve that CPG. Thank you very much. And lastly, the freedom of religion or belief CPG.
No objection to creation of the group. I think it's worth reflecting, though, on some of the possible tensions that could exist between different equality strands within the group's remit. The Scottish Parliament has legal duties under the Equality Act, the public equality duty. And I assume that that would apply to cross-party groups. So it's something that should just be kept an eye on in the future, I think.
Okay. Is that something you wish to seek further clarification from the clerks or the legal team? Or are you content to...
If the legal team are able to advise specifically whether the SPCB's Equality Act duties apply to cross-party groups, I think that would be helpful. But I think for the moment it would just be something that we might... return to at some point in the future.
Okay, so are we content to approve this CPG today?
Yes.
And we'll ask the clerks to seek that advice from the legal team.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move into private session and suspense of the committee.